Good evening, everyone. Thanks for joining us here on World Awakening tonight. It's going to be a splendid show. I'm really looking forward to it. And I want to apologize to everybody that tuned into Soul School and could only get the audio version on Monday night. It was just a technical glitch, and we'll make sure it doesn't happen again. But I will tell you that we've got a big rest of the season coming for you. And I'm looking forward to it. We've got some phenomenal guests. And tonight, one of my dearest friends, Greg Lawson, is my guest on the show. And I'm so thrilled. I'm so delighted because, you know, if all men were as good as Greg, it would be a very different world. He's just so pure of heart and so kind and so good and so funny. But before we bring Greg on, I have a special announcement to make. And hiding in our green room, which isn't green, is my original producer for A World Awakening, my dear, dear friend, another man I could say the same thing about. We need more of Tony Rathman. So, Tony, please join us.
Hello, how are you doing tonight?
Great. We had the most wonderful time this past weekend together out at the Starworks Symposium in Laughlin, Nevada.
We sure did.
Yeah, we did. It was great. We finished a movie. We did a symposium. We smoked cigarettes together. We talked a lot. We hugged a lot. We cried. We laughed. It was everything. It was wonderful. But you were there to actually see an experience that I had. Aaron's with us. Excellent. And Lori, oh, yes, he can read that. We all miss you. Well, here's the news. Tony's back.
Tony is back.
And he promised he would be. I held him to it. I didn't push. I was really good about it. Like, you know, whenever you can, come on back. And this past weekend when we were in Laughlin together, we talked about doing the show again together. And also, you know, Bill, who is the general manager of KGRA, who has, you know, stepped right in and filled Tony's shoes, wants to say a few words too. So, Bill, why don't you join us before I go on with my wicked cool story?
I have that permanent smile on my face. It is so great to see Tony back.
Thank you.
From a personal level, I love him, his wife, the Entity Voices team. I wish them happy Thanksgiving to all of them and their families. And on behalf of myself and everybody in that chat room, it's great to have you back, Tony.
Thank you, Bill. It's a pleasure to be back. It was really hard being away for that long, but, you know, everybody at KGRA is just they're just amazing. And, you know, I missed getting to produce the show for Andrea, and I'm very, very thrilled to be back.
Welcome back.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sweetheart.
Have a great show. I can now sit back and enjoy it like everybody else.
Sounds good, Bill.
So you got to witness firsthand something that happened to me when we were in Laughlin. Yep. And I know that at some point during our chats prior to this event, I must have said something to you about something always happens to me while I'm out here at Starworks. You know, there's never been a time that I went to Starworks and I didn't have something phenomenal occur while I was there. And usually more than one thing over the course of the 3 days of the symposium.
Right.
Which was a smashing success, by the way. And kudos to Paula Harrison and everybody that, you know, put that whole thing together. She had a crack staff who were on top of every element of made it look so easy when we all know that it's not. So that said, last Sunday morning at about probably 5 a.m. I had something happen, an experience. I can't call it a dream. You know, I've got 64 years of dreams under my belt. I am able to distinguish what is a dream and what is an experience and what is a visitation. And I don't know what category to put this in or if there is a category to put this in. But I went downstairs and I ran into you and I told you everything that had just freshly happened. And we sat and we smoked and we talked, and it was bizarre, absolutely bizarre.
Well, you just your personal appearance, when I turned around and saw you walking towards me, you were shaken. You were, I could tell your mind was spinning, trying to work through it, figure out what had happened.
Yeah.
You were even trembling a little bit. And mm-hmm. so I knew what you were about to tell me was going to be something absolutely just fascinating, because I'd never seen you like that. I had never seen you in that sort of state of being, because it had, you know, not occurred that long ago.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, what happened was that I was driving on the road in an older car. I think it was even a stick shift, an old car that I was not familiar with. And there used to be, it's not anymore, but there used to be what we called the sandbanks on the road between Harrisville and Pasco, Rhode Island, two of the villages. And as I was driving, all the everything, the electricity in the car kind of fuzzed out and browned out. And then I started pulling the car off the road and it went dead. And I got out and I looked up and I saw lights, like tons of lights, an enormous cluster of light vessels, but also like booming shit, just like explosions of light that were happening in the sky. And I couldn't see past above the tree line, and I wanted to get where I could see what was going on in the sky. And I started running to get to the bridge between Pasco and Harrisville. It's just a little cutover bridge, but the sky is completely open there. And I started running and I felt something. I kind of looked down peripherally on my right side, and there was something running up beside me on all fours, running as fast and as hard as it could, and grabbing a hold of the bottom of my jeans. And I said aloud, "Don't bite me, honey." And I stopped, and this creature jumped up into my arms, and I held him. And I knew it was a male. I don't know how. I didn't have any features that would have distinguished it male or female, but I knew it was male. And I looked down and there's these two onyx colored orb eyes in the shape of almonds looking back at me in abject terror. And his whole body was trembling, just quaking. And I grabbed him up tight in my arm and I started running. And something told me the only safe place was the farm, get to the farm. I paused for a moment on the top of the bridge to turn around and look back up at the sky. And it was almost like frantic messages. I mean, the anxiety level was through the roof. It was so intense for them, for me, and for this being in my arms. And my muscle still hurts in my right arm. My muscle still hurts. It's not from lugging luggage. It was from running and, oh my God. So anyway, it's a good 2.5 miles to the farm from that spot in Harrisville. And somehow I made it, and with tears rolling down my face and sweat pouring off my body and my legs in tremendous pain. And I get to the farm, and you know, I forgot to tell you, but it wasn't the farm like it is now. It was the farm like when we had it. The front porch was on. It was white. The woodshed was there. The circular driveway was there. It was like when we had it back in the 70s. Wow. And I forgot to tell you that. I remembered later. I was like, oh my God, I think I forgot to tell him that part.
Yeah, I don't remember you mentioning that.
Yep. I just said the farm. I went to the farm, but I went to the farm how it was when I was a kid. And, you know, there was no mirror for me to take a look at to see how old I was while all of this was occurring. But all I know is that I ran my heart out and just held on to him like I had birthed him myself, with this need to just protect him no matter what, protect him. All my motherly instincts, and I never had kids, but, you know, I certainly have maternal instincts. And they were boiling over, protect him. And I get to the house. Oh, and the sirens as I'm running coming from every direction. And I hear the woof, woof, woof of overhead like helicopters. I mean, it was panic mode. It was. And I got to the farm because I knew that the farm would be the only place where I would have, I don't know, maybe the energy or I don't know what, but to protect him. And as I'm standing in front of the woodshed, all these vehicles start pouring into the yard. And it's military, and it's Rhode Island State Police, and it's the local police, and it's an ambulance of all things. Wow. And all of these people start getting out of their vehicles. I didn't see a single gun drawn. There were no weapons at all that I saw. I made contact with one woman's face, and it was because she was so confused. And I could hear her thinking, What's happening here? And as they started to approach me, and his whole body is just like frozen with fear in my arms, and he's just gazing up at me like, please help me. I extended my left arm and I put my hand out and I said, stop. And when I did that, this kind of plasma, weird energy stuff came out of my fingers, and it created a dome that was actually visible. It was translucent. I could see through it, but it was visible, and no one could permeate it or penetrate it or even get near it. Wow. It just immediately pushed them back. They had to stand back away from it. And that's when I made contact with the woman, and she was really confused. And the last thing that I remember is looking up and seeing what I saw over the village directly over our head at the farm. And it was just lights. And I don't even know. I can't even say it was vessels. It was just lights, lots of lights. And I know that I was able to return him. It was my own personal ET moment. And then I woke up just like that. And my legs were two solid steel rods of pain, just absolute agony. I've never had leg cramps in my life. Apparently I get plenty of potassium. I have never ever suffered pain like that in my life. And I yelled out, and I had a suite with my dad, and it woke him. And he was, you know, way over on the other side, but it woke him up because I yelled out and I was crying, and I couldn't stand up. I had to use my arms to help lift myself up off the bed because my sister Chris has leg cramps, and she said, if you get one, stand up and, you know, walk. Well, from my hip joints to my toes was pain like I can't even describe. Sure. And by the time I got up, I threw my coat on, I grabbed my cigarettes and my room key, I walked toward the elevator. By the time I got about halfway down the hallway, all the pain was gone, like it never even happened. It was gone. By the time I got downstairs to you, it was gone. I didn't even have like residual pain or anything, although I do in this muscle. It's very strange. And so that was it. And I had to wonder, and then I called our friend Serena, my producer, my movie producer friend, who was there shooting with us that weekend.
Right.
And I told her, it was like 8 o'clock in the morning, and I told her, and she said, that's what we need to end the film with, is that you had this experience in Laughlin, Nevada, because I can't legitimately call it a dream. I know what dreams are, and usually if I have a really interesting one, I'll wake up and I'll write it down. This was not that. I don't have physiological reactions to dreams.
Right, right.
Nor does the farm look like that anymore. And I don't know if I ever drove a car that old, but it was, you know, obviously from the 70s. I must have. I had a driver's license in 76. But it was just, it was absolutely bizarre. And I wanted to share that story tonight with everyone so that they can determine, you know, either I've had a visitation or a just like, you know, it's, you know, take from it what you will. But what Tony and I talked about was the possibility that it was a test.
Yep.
To see how, what I would be willing to do to protect one of the galactic family.
Hey, that's exactly what I think it was. And I remember us talking about that, but I mean, it literally took everything that your entire life has been through with the galactic family, with your encounters, with your communications to the general public that, hey, they're, you know, they're not here to hurt us. They're keeping an eye on what we're doing, and they're here to help. They're listening, they're watching. I think that was their test just to see how you would react, what you would do, and how far you would push it. And I'm sure you passed that test with 100%, if not more, because like you said, I remember you explaining to me about willing the force field to protect him. And I mean, you just showed every ounce of who you are and what you're willing to do to protect him, get him back to where he's safe. And let's face it, I also think I said, you know, humans are some of the worst beings out there. And if anybody could possibly be concerned or worried about having interaction with us, it would definitely be extraterrestrials, because we're not good at much, let alone an interaction that we don't understand. So
yeah,
it might have been a test to see what you did.
It was a significant event for me. And it really left a mark. And I've thought about it incessantly ever since. It never leaves my consciousness, Tony. But sure that said, I've used up a few minutes here that I want to devote to Greg. So let's bring him on. And everybody, I think everybody in our chat room probably knows who Greg Lawson is. And there he is. Look at you.
Look at me.
You are wonderful. How are you? Thank you for joining me tonight, honey.
It is my pleasure, my dear friend. Thank you.
Well, I have a professional question for you.
Yes.
Because you're a law enforcement officer. There's this jerk that drives in front of my house. He's new to the neighborhood, or he just got this piece of crap car that must have holes drilled in the muffler or whatever. And it's the loudest car that I ever heard ever. And I can always tell when he's coming by at least a half a mile away. So he's not just disturbing my peace of mind and shaking up my little dinky dog and pissing my father off royally. He's disturbing the whole neighborhood. Oh, yeah. And when he rounds the corner at the end of this side of the road and then goes up, you can hear him all the way to the next town over. I'm not kidding. Okay. And, you know, yeah, do I want to call him out and, you know, rat him out to the Winter Garden police? Yes, I do. He's traveling so fast, I can't get a license plate number. Would it be wrong of me to purchase? See, you're already laughing. Would it be wrong of me?
Yes.
To buy a set of, you know, those spikes that they throw down to stop vehicles.
Just to answer this simplistically, yes, it would be wrong for you to do that.
Are you sure I could get in trouble for doing that? Because all I want to do is slow him down permanently.
Oh, I want to slow him down also. Yeah. I can think of all kinds of things I would love to do. We have a gentleman like that in our neighborhood and, he lives right down the street, maybe two blocks down every morning, same time. He rides his Harley right down my street and has his radio just blaring on this Harley. And he wakes me up every time I try to stay in. So I feel your pain. And
are you sure it would be illegal though?
Yeah. I'm sorry. I don't want to see
you. 50 states?
Yeah. I don't want to see you go to jail for that one, but yeah, that would be interesting. I don't know if you have any law enforcement that routinely goes around there, but
no, they don't. No,
yeah.
Because they tell me they have no place to hide.
Yeah.
And that's true. They really don't have a place to hide.
Right.
Where I live, you know, they would have to, you know, be in a swamp because I'm like right on the lake and we've had, I don't know how many hurricanes this season.
Well, hopefully, so, yeah. Hopefully that POS car that he's driving will have issues and maybe, you know, maybe it won't work that much longer. Let's keep our fingers crossed on that. I can think of a lot of things I'd like to do.
Sometimes when I'm particularly cranky and he goes by, yeah. I just yell at the top of my lungs, knowing he cannot hear me. Drive it up a tree, you son of a bitch. Don't take anybody innocent with you.
Right.
You know, and I know that too. I mean, on some level, you know, you can be my compass tonight, you know, my moral compass, Greg, and just tell me that I shouldn't wish, you know, him a close encounter with a telephone pole or a tree a stone wall or, you know, anything other than a car full of innocent people as he goes ripping around a corner that's like, I don't know what degrees it is. It's like, it's almost like driving in a circle. It's so dangerous. And
I'm going to give you
my law enforcement friend.
I think I'm going to give you some advice that you would give me if I had the same thing. Wish good things for that person because you probably wouldn't want to have their life if they're that big of an idiot and, you know, causing issues like that when he knows better. There's other stuff going on in that person's life that probably isn't good either.
But yeah, well, you know,
good thoughts.
Anybody that makes that much of noise is compensating for something.
You know? Oh yeah, absolutely, absolutely. You know? Hey, I have to tell you a story just because it's, you know, we're talking irritating. Neighbors that aren't real clear on etiquette and stuff like that. When Lynn and I first moved into this home, the house next door came for sale about 2 months later. And I came home one day and there was a kid walking between our fences going in my backyard. And I said, "Hey, can I help you?" And he goes, "Oh, I'm just going back here." I'm like, "Okay, that's my backyard, man. You know, you don't do that." And then he kind of got a little attitude with me. And I just told him, get off my property. Go away. You know, I was an old man. Get off my lawn. Get out of here.
Yeah.
And he walked on. And I went inside the house. And then I heard my dog. And I went down to the back window. And I could see him through the woods. I have probably about 200 feet of woods behind my house. So you can't see any houses behind there. And he was back there and I went out and confronted him and he was standing out there smoking a cigarette. He was probably 13, 14 years old. And I said, "Hey man, you're in my backyard. You need to leave." "Oh, this is nobody's backyard. This is the woods." I was like, get out of here, kid. And he's like, "Get away from me." And so I started touching him. I'm like poking at him, right? I'm like, "Get out of my yard. Quit touching me." So I'm, you know, "Okay, go away, kid." So he leaves. Him and his dad come back later. His dad's mad. "I understand you were poking my son. You were touching my son." I was like, "Yeah, I'm about to touch you if you don't get off my yard, get off my property and go away. I'm gonna throw both of you in jail." And so they leave. Well, a couple of days later, I look in the back, same kid. And now he's got his friends and they're back in the woods and there's a little clearing and they're all back there smoking. It's early in the morning. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to go ahead and take care of this my way. So the kids leave, and I spent the next 3 weeks, probably 4 weeks, with a 5 gallon bucket. I had at that time a dog named Bumpy. He was a 105 pound Labrador. Mm-hmm. And so I spent the next 3-4 weeks collecting the dog food, recycled dog food that was, yes, in the backyard. Yes. And after I did that, I went back there to their little smoke area, and I raked all the leaves up, and I added water to this. I put it all over the place out there. I put the leaves back on it, and I set up in my window the next morning when those kids were going to school with my cup of coffee in my robe. And Lynn is like, "What are you doing?" I was like, "Nothing, honey. Go to work."
Nothing, honey.
And I saw these kids go back there, and they had taken the furniture, the little patio furniture from my next door neighbor's house, and put it over there because it was for sale. Nobody lived there, and put it over there. And they had a little smoke area. And after about 5 minutes, I noticed one of them looks down, the other one's looking down, and they're all looking at their feet going, "Oh my God." I never saw those kids ever again. So I think your dog's too small to collect up enough remnants to put in the front yard or put on the road for him to run over. But but anyway, you can be creative to have
spray people paint.
Yeah.
Spray paint. It's a freshly paved road. It's nice and black.
Yeah.
White spray paint would stick out like a sore thumb.
Right.
I could write in both directions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But if I did it right in front of my house, everybody would know it was me.
But yeah. And you know what? It's good to have these little problems, right? The little irritating.
It is, because
problems.
It helps me not think of the big, big, humongous, gigantic problems.
Right.
It does. You know? It's a minor, it's just a little deflective technique, I guess, that the universe has given me. And yeah, okay, so I think that wishing him well is just way too altruistic. but I promise not to wish him dead anymore.
If his life gets better, maybe he'll quit doing that. Maybe get a better car. I don't know.
I think he'd need to grow another appendage to, you know, feel like the big man. I'm sorry.
You almost ruined my
microphone. Poor timing. I know. Poor timing. I know. Sorry. Okay, so hey, let's talk paranormal. What do you want to talk about? This is your show, baby.
Oh, it's my show.
With my blah blah blah, my stories.
Oh, that's how this works. I wasn't for sure about that.
Yeah, this is your show, and we get to talk about whatever you want to talk about.
Well, okay, I have Andrea Perrin on, and I've always wanted to ask her. So, in this whole thing, you know, I don't know whether you've experienced this in your life, but I'm at that point in my life where I'm about to thinking about either changing careers or retiring or doing something like that.
Sure. Yeah, me too.
And I sit back and I have that existential dilemma of, you know, what is this all about? You said something earlier that I think matters. You said that you have never had children. I don't have children. Lynn doesn't have children. And I think that adds another dimension, either subtracts or adds another dimension to someone's existence and the way that we view the world. When we get to a point, it's like, what is this all about? Mm-hmm. So I ask Andrea Perrin, what is this all about? What's the end goal here?
I don't know. I wish that I did. I think that the end goal, I think that right now we are squarely in the midst of the paradigm shift. For those that don't understand what that means, in the most simplistic form, that was then and this is now, and nothing's ever going to be the same, you know, and not just post-COVID, but post a lot of things that have been going on in the world. You know, we dared to say never again at the end of World War II. And look what we're staring at right now. You know, just Bucha, if it had just been Bucha, just that requires, you know, crimes against humanity charges to be tried at The Hague. You know, just that. And this whole country has been decimated and the people so severely abused and degraded that, you know, life as they knew it literally changed just like that overnight. Yeah. You know, and we said never again. We need to live up to the mantra. I think that we need to dare to have hope for the future. I am grateful every day that I did not feel the need to breed. I would not want, I mean, my responsibility in this world is to my family, my friends, and to the center of my universe, of course, which is the Princess Peanut Buttercup.
Of right course here. It is. Yeah.
This is my baby. She's resting comfortably right now. She'll have her moment later when she says, I'm ready for my close-up, Mr. DeMille. She will absolutely jump in my lap at some point. You know, my plate is full just with what I've got. And I look at my three right. sisters that had like tons of kids, seven grandchildren between the three of them. Christine and I didn't ever marry or have kids. And we talk about this frequently, the two of us. Because there is something so liberating about not having added to the carbon footprint of the planet, not having the responsibility, the, you know, the joy, of course, but also the heartache that comes with children. For instance, my sister Nancy lost one of her grandchildren in a flood in Waverly, Tennessee.
I remember that.
Last yeah. year, 8 years old. You know, my sister lost her faith over it.
I don't doubt it.
It's over. She's like, there can't be a benevolent God that would have allowed this to happen. You know, and then I think of the children that were gassed in Syria. And I think of the children that were blown to bits in Zaporizhia. And I think of what's going on in Yemen and what's going on in Saudi Arabia and what's going on in North Korea. And, you know, Russia, I don't even have the words. I just don't even have the words. And I look at the world and I thank God I didn't have children that I would worry about with my dying breath, would worry about what kind of world we've left behind for them. You know, the degradation of this planet, the actual physical abuse of this planet. We are pestilence on the planet. We are the only animal, the only creature on Earth that fouls its own nest without remorse in an unconscionable way. And I say you cannot have a crisis of conscience if you don't have a conscience. And there are too many human beings on this planet that do not possess a conscience. And yeah. so, you know, as much of a misfit as I feel here to have had the extra added responsibility of children would have been a disaster for me. First of all, none of them would have left the house before the age of 40. Like left the house or the yard, maybe if it was really well fenced. But no, I'm like, I do have very, very strong protective instincts. And I think that was, you know, borne out in the experience that I had on last Sunday, which just bizarre.
Yeah. I sit back and you've had that perspective also of several decades just watching things kind of change. And when you're in the middle of things changing, you don't see it as much. You know, if you took snapshots every yeah. decade and saw the change, it would be pretty stark. And mm-hmm. many, many people that set up our Constitution and that sort of thing would be very shocked at where yes. we are at this point. Yes,
they would.
The thing that you don't hear people talking too much about is one of the most powerful organizations in the United States, which is the Department of Education.
Yes.
I went back and got my master's in education, and I wrote extensively in my master's how the Department of Education is indoctrinating people and changing our thought processes of what we think is important and what's not. And when you fracture a society and you try to make as many individualistic, try to identify people with very, and this is pre-COVID, this is pre all the pandemic and all the riots and all that stuff. When I was working on this in 2014, 2015. And when you fracture different factions of people, even within right. their own factions, pretty soon everybody is fractured so much, you just have general turmoil and nobody can really band together to do anything. And one of the things, and you know, I mean, I have a little over 40 years of public service, 32 years law enforcement, 10 years military. And right now, in what I'm doing, it is pretty hard to find individuals that are willing to think larger than themselves.
Yes.
They're not, they don't really understand the idea of being a part of something that's mm-hmm. greater than yourself. And, you know, to listen to John F. Kennedy say, you know, ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country is so foreign to a 20-year-old today yeah. that it would, you know, they don't even identify with it. And you can look at a lot of these little things. I don't want to force people to have an allegiance to something, but saying the Pledge of Allegiance for your country, it kind of binds people together, even mm-hmm. even if you don't like what people do in your country.
Right.
You can't argue the Constitution. You can't argue the fact that, you know, people will look at an American flag today and they will say, oh, you know, it's dirty. It's full of corruption. It's this and that. That's not what the flag represents. That yeah. is what individual people do against the Constitution, against the laws, against the flag, against exactly. the ideal. The right. flag is something to look at and aspire to. We'll never reach it because we're flawed. Mm-hmm. And
but it is a symbol.
It is a symbol of a great
a
thing.
A perfect union.
It's a great thing.
And that's what the paradigm shift is all about here, is forming a more perfect union, yeah. coming into the unified field of oneness, the consciousness that we are all in this together.
We are.
That absolutely. We are. And, you know, like it or not, like your neighbor or not, you know, which I have the world's best neighbors. So, you know, and yet we're very different and we think very differently. And occasionally we argue about politics and occasionally we argue about, you know, sociological things or, you know, very bright people. One's a teacher. And her husband's kind of, you know, right wingy. And, you know, we get into it and we mix it up and we talk about it. And then we hug each other and you know, we've had our discussion and here's my point of view and here's yours. And we meet at the picnic table and we talk about it. And then we take the dogs for a walk. And then, you know, there's a way to get along with people that you don't agree with and still have respect for them.
Yeah.
And we've lost that as a society. Right. We've lost it. We're fractured. And, well, you know, I can't associate with them. I have friends, Greg, that have not seen or spoken with members of their own family
right.
for yep. the last 5 or 6 years. Have and not that, even, I mean, cut off contact completely with their whole family.
Yeah. I will push that back on the Department of Education. The way that they are teaching now is a straight line on whatever it is your opinion. They're not teaching debate. They're not teaching politeness. They're not teaching, right. you know, it's so crazy. So I've had leadership courses in the Army, the Navy, and the Air Force. I've had many leadership courses within law enforcement. Part of my master's was in occupational workforce and leadership studies. Out of all of that leadership, all that extra stuff, all those books, all those peer-reviewed articles, everything, I learned two things: be kind and yeah. share. Yeah. And I learned that when I was four.
Yeah.
And it's like yeah. everything can revolve around
parenting,
that.
Which is part of your education.
Yes. And we can all wrap ourselves around that. If we would just have a little bit of patience, let people say what they're going to say as long as they're being semi-polite and, you know, productive. And maybe they'll have something that you didn't consider. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't like hanging out with a whole bunch of people that think the same way, because you get that groupthink and you get that echo chamber of, yeah, this is the right way, this is the right way, this is the right way. I spent six months in Egypt. I spent about a total of 2 years of my life all around the Middle East. You mentioned Yemen earlier. I was in Yemen, mm-hmm. Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, all in that area. People, they think Americans, all Americans think a certain way. And we think that all Islamic countries think a certain way.
A certain way.
And it's not. It's not at all. No. And so we have just as much dangerous stuff here in the United States as very, very militant Islamic groups. Yeah. And so I just really hope that somehow somebody gets a hold of the Department of Education, because this is where this is coming from. It's taken decades to get to where we are now.
Yeah.
And I, you know, it's funny. Somebody asked me the other day, so what's your political affiliation? I said, nah, mine's more of a political philosophy. I'm a communist libertarian. It's like, if you're mean to old people and animals, yeah. I will put you in a gulag. Yeah. And then on the other side, it's none of your business what I do in my house. Nobody's business what adults do in their life that doesn't affect anybody else. So it's very, it's kind of like, you know, so my voting habits are very eclectic.
Eclectic. I was going to use that word. Yes. I have a real problem with books being banned. Especially Pulitzer Prize winning books being banned, and telling children that they cannot read this and they cannot learn that, and don't crack the spine of that book because it will, you know, it will, it's a perversion, or, you know, I mean.
Yeah. And that's the funny thing is read more books, read that book and then read the antithesis of that book and figure out where the reality is in the middle.
And the state you live in are both banning books actively right now under the guise of establishing parental rights. Mm-hmm. Well, here's what I think about that. Leave the books alone. Leave them exactly where they have been for decades and decades, which is the library. And if your kid checks out a book that you as a parent find objectionable, presuming you've read it, then you decide whether your child can read that book or not at home. But to take the Department of Education in the state of Florida literally by the throat, which is what's happening here. I mean, it is. It's exactly what's happening here. And, you know, and teachers are leaving in droves.
Oh, yeah.
In droves. They're like, absolutely. I want none of this. I have a friend who's a librarian. She calls me crying every 3 days. You know, she's just so, so upset about what is happening, you know, from the panhandle to Miami. And you live in Texas. And that was the beginning of it.
Nationwide. My next door neighbor's a librarian, so
that's where it began.
Yeah.
And now this is spreading, just like, you know, as a woman, you think I'm not upset that having fought the fight for bodily autonomy 50 years ago with my mother, of a mother of five living children who almost died because she had a dead fetus in her and the state of Rhode Island would not allow her to have a therapeutic abortion until she was literally on death's door.
Yeah.
And the Jewish hospital is who saved her life. You know, in 1968, you know, we're not going back. Right. And this is war. This is a fight. This is a serious fight that I didn't think that at 64 I would be fighting again. But I am. You know, I mean, if you don't like abortion, as far as I'm concerned, you don't like abortion, you really shouldn't have one. But, you know, don't tell my neighbor who's in her fourth month and her water broke and she's going toxic, that she can't get an abortion in the state of Florida anymore and has to, you know, fly to a New England state to get the medical treatment that she needs. And her doctor is afraid to do anything about it because he could go to jail. Right. You know, I mean, this is, I'll say it out loud. This is as fucked up gets. And yeah. I've had it up to here. And I'm mad all the time, Greg. I am on a low level burn all the time, unless the heat gets turned up and I start screaming at the television. My poor little dog, she's like, oh, mommy's upset again. Oh, where's grandpa? I'll go get scratched by him. You know, I mean, really, right. This is a difficult time to be alive. This
right. is a yeah, it's very confusing
time to be
right?
a citizen of this country. And it is a difficult time, you know, for us to confront our demons.
Yeah.
And we have to, but we can't afford to demonize each other. It's about right. educating each other.
Yeah, and as far as that, that's the bottom line. Is, you know, you can look at, we're talking about education. Look at the simple things. Why wouldn't they teach how to balance your checkbook? Now, we don't have checks anymore.
They don't teach balance. Cursive writing yeah. anymore.
Why?
Or civics. And hasn't that yeah. worked out well?
And so this is all by design. Yeah. The Department of Education Dumbed is doing things for a reason. Sure. Yeah. And that's yep. the other thing on both sides, right? You can look far right, far left. Don't read this. Don't listen to this program. Don't engage in this argument, right? Or yep. or whatever it is. And that's a particular design that I've always found very interesting when people says, don't do something because it's bad for you. Well, maybe I'm intelligent or, you know, a decent enough person that I can read this and read something else. And now I understand kind of both sides of it. You look at, we had to read that book, 1984,
yeah, George Orwell's. Yeah. And now we get to live it. Wow.
Oh my God. Right.
Dystopian okay, so, society. Welcome so, to our world.
Yeah. You travel. I travel. This is the funny thing about the United States is we have plenty of our own problems, right? Go anywhere south of the Texas border
yeah.
and come back and talk to me in a couple of weeks and tell me about how horrible it is here in the United States.
Yeah.
That's all you got to do is just go south.
Yeah.
I live closer to Guatemala than I do Washington, D.C., mm-hmm. So I am here every day and I experience certain things every day that people don't like to talk about in the news and don't like to follow up with that are realities. Mm-hmm. And when you just shut yourself off and say, oh, America's horrible, we have some issues. I don't want to live anywhere else. Europe, there's a lot of cool stuff in Europe and I do like Europe. I don't know whether I'd want to live there. And certainly, I love London. I love London. Anywhere you go in London, you are being listened to and you are on camera.
Yeah.
Everywhere. It's the most.
CCTV everywhere.
It is the most covered city.
City
yes.
in the world.
Yeah. And how it turned out that way when George Orwell predicted this whole thing. You know, this yeah. is what it's going to be like. They're going to be. The very next thing is. Let's see. We want to make sure that you have this type of thermostat in your house so we can monitor what temperature you're setting into your house because we don't want you to use up too much energy.
Yeah. Stay out of my house. Stay out of that? My uterus. Stay out of my brain.
Right.
Get
right?
out.
Yeah. So, yes, the more you educate yourself on stuff, and that means understanding both sides of the argument, the better. Not, we're not going to allow you to read this book because it's too controversial. That's scary. That's really scary.
Well, and you know, the thing is that, you know, the LGBTQ population in this country it's relatively small.
Mm-hmm.
It averages 10% of the entire world population is exclusively homosexual. And that's an average worldwide. The trans is like 0.05, you know?
Very small, yeah.
Very, very small. And yet that has been turned into an issue that is a non-issue. It's just being used, you know, to create divisiveness and to, you know, the whole critical race theory thing. That comes out of Harvard Law School. That does not exist in, it's not something that is taught. You know, the governor of Florida, the still governor of Florida, passed a law that said the don't say gay bill. I'm sure you've probably heard of it.
Believe it or not, I'm like this these days. I okay. stay in my lane, and I know what my job is.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I'll drive myself insane. You know.
Yeah.
I graduated one of our recruit classes today.
Oh, okay. Right, so yeah, you've got the blinders on right now. Well, this happened in the last few months.
Yeah.
And you know, basically Disney is upset about it. So, you know, basically, I mean, there's all kinds of retribution and ugliness and vengeful stuff going on with Disney, and the school teachers are leaving in droves, and, you know, and we're dealing with this, and it's all wrapped up under the guise of education.
Sure.
All yep. of this, all, yes, you is. Know, it's just all, you know, swept into a bucket mm-hmm. of sludge. And being called education. I think that on some level, we're all responsible for our own self-education. You know, I like to say, in the age of global communications, ignorance is a choice.
It is, for sure.
It's a choice. And so, yeah, I'm really now getting to the point where, I mean, I'm like you, Greg. I mean, this past year, I've done a lot of writing. I haven't published. Everything's like in the works. I haven't published anything new because I feel like we're moving at the speed of light, that, you know, this is happening and this is happening. And like the story that I just told at the beginning of the, you know, of the show tonight, like I'm still trying to process that. And it was a week ago. And I still can't even wrap my mind around what that was, why it happened, you know, why I had this experience that I did, what's the intrinsic meaning of it, you know? And so, yeah, in that respect, sometimes it's good to just put those blinders on for a little bit and focus on this one thing, you know, let's focus on this one thing and extrapolate out of it what I can learn from it, what lesson was inherent to it, what message came from it, and focus, because we are so fractured and yes, so scattered yep. and so inundated with stimuli that our brains are fried
yep.
and COVID just made it worse. The isolation,
sure.
you know, it was within the last 6 months, the Ipsos poll, which is really one of the most accurate national polls. I think it was Pew Ipsos. Did a nationwide survey of people from the age of 20 to 50. I'm almost positive that was the demographic, which is large.
Right.
And yep. asked one question. Or two questions, and that being, are you suffering anxiety and depression, and have you considered harming yourself? Over 50% admitted yeah. to suffering extreme anxiety and depression, and more than 25% said they had considered harming themselves.
Yeah, I believe
those numbers are off the freaking charts.
Yep.
Suicide is off the charts. Gun violence is off the charts. I mean, you just lived through Uvalde. What a nightmare. What a nightmare. What a horrible, horrible thing. Yep. And yet, you know, there are people in this country that are like, oh, there was another school shooting. Oh, okay. I mean, we've after Columbine, remember how shocked we all were by Columbine?
Oh, yeah.
I leveled all of us that this could happen in this country. And now we're like 350 school shootings later. And it's like, oh, there was another school shooting. How many died? How many died?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's where we are, Greg. And you're right. If we went back over the course of our lives and just took one snapshot of our lives from each year and laid it out on a table, we would be able to examine our entire history, not only as a society and a culture, but individually. It's how shocking. We have changed, including our attitudes and our predispositions and how we have matured and in some cases not matured. I think this is we're in an inflection point that requires a pause to reflect.
Absolutely we are. Yeah. And you know, when you have people that have been raised to be argumentative, they've been raised to,
and that's all they've ever seen.
Yeah. And to be over the top to get, you know, more likes on whatever their page is that they have. Yeah. And also to be, you know, staunchly independent, which is a good thing. However, you know, seriously, if you don't have law enforcement, there will be men that will step up and take care of business in a
their own way.
Yeah, their own way. That's what's going to happen. And so, like people like myself, where do I find law enforcement officers, new law enforcement officers? I can answer that question. I don't. Our applications are so low at this point.
Really?
Oh, absolutely. Nobody wants to be a cop.
I'm surprised about that.
No, nobody wants to be a cop. And think about our jails. No, I'm willing to bet just about all of your listeners can think about when you're in elementary school, junior high, high school. They never knew anybody that said, you know, when I grow up, I'm going to be a jailer. Nobody said that. Of course, they didn't say when I grow up, I'm going to be a garbage man or I'm going to be, you know, whatever the very difficult jobs are out there. But where do you find people to work in the jails? At this point, after all the riots and after much of the nonsense that was put out as far as statistical, no statistical value at all, but they would put it out just to put it out. Law enforcement people don't want to do that. You know, we're having to jack our base pay way up to try to get people in, and we're still it is a super challenge when you accept 200 applications and you hire four people because of their backgrounds and things like that. You know, people that that have good solid values and want to do something for their community is pretty low at this point. It's much more about how much money can I make? You know, what's the most successful job I can get into and make? Mm-hmm. You know,
yeah, not thinking in terms of a career in public service, whatever that looks like. Yeah.
And so, you know, all law enforcement is in horrible shape right now. I know cops that are making $200,000 to $250,000 a year because they're working overtime. Many agencies out there, you work a regular 40-hour week. Many agencies out there used to allow you to work an additional 18 hours a week overtime. That is all the way up to 32 hours a week now. You can work 10, you know, 10-hour days, 7 days a week, and they're not going to say anything to you because they're happy to have you there.
Wow.
Yeah. So
that's frightening.
Yeah.
And another reason why the phrase defund the police are the three most stupid words ever you know, jammed together in the course of human history.
And when you do that, you look at, okay, you have, what do you have to have as law enforcement? Well, you have to have 911 response. That's what you have to have.
You have to have EMT. You have to have medical units. You have to have, people that are trained in de-escalation. Social workers. I mean, there's so much that is encompassed under that umbrella law enforcement.
Right. And that's what happens is, so the DWI units go away, the traffic units go away, your SWAT unit is defunded. So many agencies are so short on people now, most of their special operations units are gone. Their motorcycle units are gone. And so you look at all that and it's like, okay, how is this going to be the pendulum swing? Is this going to be the thing that wakes up a bunch of people that were indoctrinated into, the argument that, the United States is evil and we should fight against it and overturn the government or whatever their agenda is.
Whatever the agenda is. Believing in fake shit. Like,
right,
QAnon that was started as a joke online in Europe, and look how that has exploded in our faces. You know, I mean, this is.
I ask myself,
we're in nutso world is where we are.
Across the board, are we better today than we were, let's say, 10 years ago?
No,
absolutely not. Right?
No.
Because of social
media, because of indoctrination. Because our educational standards have virtually disappeared. The bar was lowered so much, you have to step over it.
So let me add something to that. Mm-hmm. I have a very, very close family member that is a teacher. The latest class, when they reclassed up and are actually going to school, was pandemonium. He can get no control over his class. If he pulls two or three people out a class and sends them to the principal blames him. He's not, you know, tells him, you can't control your class. Mm-hmm. What am I going to do with you?
My neighbor is telling me the same thing. Yeah. She can't control her kids. She can't.
Right. And when we're looking at a failure rate of 70%.
Yep.
And then they tell them, okay, well, wait a second. You can't fail these kids.
Right.
You need to pass them.
Right.
So you do some sort of magical math and grade on some sort of curve and you bend that thing up and you pass them.
Yeah. And they go into the next grade, utterly unprepared, and they get passed throughout that one into the next grade where they are utterly unprepared.
And people will pass along this information to the point of, because no authority or legitimate news agency is putting this information forward, it turns into rumor and it turns into what people say, oh, that's not what's going on. It is absolutely what is going on right now. Absolutely.
But if you don't know a teacher personally and don't know the challenges that they're facing in their classrooms, you know, one of the worst things that ever happened in this country was by necessity, the COVID shutdown to try to, you know, we'd have at least a million more people dead if we hadn't done that. You know, however, it had the liabilities that came along with it, the isolation, the parents' inability to keep a roof over their head and teach their kids from home and monitor what was going on. And what about all the people that didn't have Wi-Fi, didn't have computers, didn't have access to the technology that was necessary for these children to continue to learn at home for the year and sometimes year and a half that they missed? Not only did COVID lower the life expectancy of America, but it also dumbed down America because of how many kids turned and walked away and are now uneducable because they're so far behind.
Right. It's going to be very interesting. I mean, there's going to be some great books and great papers written a decade from now about how we handle all this. I made the prediction when all this happened initially, as soon as all this happened, I looked at Lynn and I said, you watch, there will be far more deaths and far more pain going on by the way we're handling it than the actual virus did itself. I'm not saying that the certain shutdowns needed to happen. And if you weren't going to shut down the schools, and that means that these kids were going to possibly get this,
and bring it home to their grandparents.
Yeah. And have mild symptoms, but it's the teachers that are going to get sick and die. It's the parents that are going to get sick and die.
And so, they did. They did.
And so I don't know how we could have better handled it. I mean, we know more things now in retrospect, and we can Monday morning quarterback it all day long.
Sure.
So we find ourselves in this position now, and hopefully we will have learned some things, but the problem is one group will have learned, you know, if they tell me not to go to work again, I'm going to tell them go screw themselves, and I'm going to go to work anyway, because this, you know, Fauci or whatever they're going to blame is like, hey, they gave me bad information, I don't care. I don't know how that's all going to work out, but I think, you know, you just be reasonable about what you do, and try to be respectful. And it's funny how some people get very upset somebody's wearing a mask, and they're upset that somebody else isn't wearing a mask. And the way I look at that is if it makes you feel better for me to wear a mask, I'll wear a mask. For sure, I know that when I speak, sometimes some spit will fly out, and it could do something.
You've spit on me a couple of times. Well, I was okay with that.
But that was on purpose.
Oh. You smart ass.
So I just, you know, we're at this really weird place where we have a lot of very educated people that are passing along good information, and then they're passing along bad information as well. And it seems like they're really trying to manipulate things so much. And so as, you know, like you said, a world awakening, you know, how do we handle this? The only way I can, you know, you said it's a war. And it is, but
it is predominantly, like I said, a war of words, but it might not stay that way.
I know. And that's where I always tell people are like, man, aren't you pissed off about this? Aren't you this or that? I'm like, my, skill set is military and law enforcement. Mm-hmm. I know when it's time for me to do something. And it has to be really bad for me to step in and do something. Yeah. So I try to, like, you know, we were talking earlier, and when I say I put the blinders on, my blinders are not so that I don't see what's happening. Right. My blinders are more like filters.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, okay, that's something I can.
Protective. It's a coping skill, Greg.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I haven't. So years ago, when you work high risk stuff in law enforcement, you learn very quickly not to listen to the news, not to listen to radio, because they will be talking about you on the news. And most of the time, I've had not horrible things said about me, but I've had things said about me that are absolutely not true. I've been in situations where I'm providing surveillance on a particular event, and I have watched personally, I have watched media people come up and organize groups of people to make them get on camera and look like there's more people there protesting than there actually is.
Yeah.
So I've watched the news people design news. I know this happens. Mm-hmm. And so with the background stuff that I know, you know, I think the only thing that we can really do is just try to do our due diligence and try to make every decision that we come to be something that is a good decision, not a punishment decision, some sort of growth decision, and just be polite until it's time not to be polite, obviously, but have that patience. Let somebody vent for 5 minutes if that's what they need to do. But if they're not cycling down, then, you know, pretty soon it's like, all right, we have a problem at this point. But sometimes it feels very good to vent. And sometimes even when you're venting, you say things that maybe not necessarily meant 100%, but
yeah,
it sure felt good saying it.
Yeah.
And sometimes people need that in law enforcement. You'll see law enforcement officers get to a house. There's a family disturbance. They break it up. And the man or the woman or the person, whatever, decides to pick up a chair and break it and kick over their TV and yank the phone off the hook and knock a picture off. And then the cop will run over there and get into a fight with this person to stop them from tearing up their own stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't make a lot of sense.
And then it escalates into something worse, which is why I am sure, saw the murder of George Floyd.
Yeah.
Why would anybody think that would not spark a worldwide uprising?
Sure.
Not just in this country. I was part of the uprising.
Right.
Because, can you imagine the hubris of four officers, one with his neck being hit, with his knee being jammed into the neck of a man begging for his life.
Right.
Who didn't even tell one of the other officers to go take that phone away from that 17-year-old girl. She's filming all of this. They didn't care. They didn't care. He was going to do what he did. And, herein lies the problem, Greg. Not all officers are you. And in Florida and in Georgia, just in recent cases, we are dealing with situations, when I'm up in Georgia and I'm watching the Atlanta news, I'm like, oh God, put it on Jeopardy, please.
Right.
And then when I'm down here, I'm like, Dad, go find Wheel of Fortune. I can't do this. We are in a place in this country where the polarization has gotten to, such an extent that the police are afraid of everyone and everyone's afraid of the police, and you can lose your life, your death by driving, death by eating a cheeseburger in a parking lot, death by, running for fear of your life and being shot in the back. And you know that this is happening all over this country, from Minneapolis to Orlando to Dallas to Los Angeles to Baltimore, Chicago, where so many people who are people of color, predominantly African-American, but also the Hispanic community, are afraid. And so what's the common denominator here? Why didn't the 19 officers that stood outside in the hallway for 70 minutes while the children inside that classroom were massacred and bled out, there were as many officers as there were victims of that. And they were afraid, Greg. And is the vibration of fear that is actually causing so much of the dynamic that is so destructive to our society. Love and hate are not opposites. The opposite of love is fear. Fear is its polar opposite, and from fear is born hatred. But fear is the mother emotion. And Greg, how do we get to a place? I know this is a rhetorical question. Nobody has the answer, because if we did, we should be king and queen of the world. But how do we get to a place where we can understand more? As Marie Curie said, now is the time to understand more so right. that we may fear less.
Yeah. Through legitimate education. And when I say yeah. legitimate, I mean, non-manipulative education, right. not an education that I want this outcome. I'm going to manipulate all the information to get that outcome. I'm telling you, the Department of Education is the most powerful organization in the United States. It's one of the most powerful movements in the world as far as just other countries, the way that they educate and indoctrinate their people. And one of the ways is like you look at let's say of the criminal homicides committed by law enforcement. And the reason I say this is I teach this. And when you look at, let's say, 40 billion calls for service nationwide of law enforcement in, let's say, a 10-year period, and you have 72 legitimate homicides committed by law enforcement, that ends up being a conviction of some sort of criminal thing. A homicide just means a human killing a human. And then there's categories of that, you know, right. there's murder, criminal negligent homicide here in the United, or here in Texas, criminal negligent homicide, capital murder, and negligent homicide. And you look at it, and it kind of depends on how you define it. And then when you break it down, it's like, okay, well, a bunch of these were legitimate why they shot. One of the interesting things that the news will do is another unarmed man of color was killed. He didn't have a gun. Nope, he didn't. And he was killed because he was fighting over the officer's gun. They don't add that in there. And there's so many of those
I see the dilemma that you face.
And so do you think defunding the police or making the occupation of law enforcement a less desirable occupation is going to help get better cops?
No, it's not. And if you want to live in a civil society, you should teach civics in school, and you should make sure that you're teaching, your children are having a proper upbringing in terms of respecting authority. And you damn well better have someone who's out there protecting the whole entire concept of law and order. And it's not just the judiciary. Right. It starts on the ground with the police. We have the best police in the whole state of Florida, right here in Winter Garden, right here. They're great. You can walk right in, have a talk with any of them anytime, bitch and complain about whatever's on your last raw nerve, and they'll take care of it. We have a system here. Our house got broken into about 5 years ago, 4 or 5 years ago. And then my father decided that, you know, maybe we should have security. Okay, Dad.
That's called the awakening.
Yeah, the awakening. It's called awakening. Letting the horse out of the barn and then closing the door is what it's called. And I mean, every now and then a friend will come over and they'll open a door that they shouldn't, or, you know, whatever. And that alarm goes off and they're here in 3 seconds. I mean, they're here in like 3 seconds because they saw how upset my father was when they came to help him after the break-in, you know, and everybody knows each other. And isn't it about community policing and the people getting to know the cops that they might have to count on to save their lives?
Yeah. You know, the funny thing about that is, you know, who really solves crimes? Nosy neighbors solve crimes.
Nosy neighbors. That's Gladys Kravitz.
You bet,
with
man.
The binoculars.
Oh,
that's
you
my mother.
Bet.
My mother is Gladys Kravitz.
Those are the ones that solve our burglaries, our thefts, our auto thefts and stuff, is people paying attention but also willing to actually come forward and say, I saw this, I saw that, you know.
And that's a scary, scary proposition.
Right.
To come forward and say, I saw this.
You bet.
You know, witnesses are not always as protected as they need to be, depending on the nature of the crime. And so you can lose your life being honest and doing the right thing. It's not like it happens all the time, but it does happen.
There's the
fear factor.
There was a case study on a murder that happened in New York. And I want to say it was 43 people actually witnessed the murder, and none of them made a 911 call. None of them.
And they all witnessed it.
And they were terrified.
The woman that was, beaten half to death. I think she was a Chinese national or something. And just an older woman and beaten half to death out in front of a hotel. And the people that were working inside went and closed the doors and walked away. And, I'm sorry, but, again, how can you have a crisis of conscience if you do not have a conscience?
I just spoke at a college here a couple of days ago. I spoke at their criminal justice club that they have. They have a huge criminal justice department at this institution. And I went and spoke with them, and it really, it was very enlightening for me to look at the kids that were there. And I asked them all, I said, raise your hand if you, when you were growing up, you're like, when I grow up, I'm going to be a cop. And not a single one of them raised their hand. And I was like, thank God. I was like, these are the people that we need. You have an idea of what you think that law enforcement should be and how you're going to do things. You'll come into law enforcement. They're going to educate you on the law and tactical procedures. And then you will be able to go out and represent your community based on your values, on how you interact. And I think that's very important. I am a reluctant cop. I never thought I would be a cop. And I did for a whole series of reasons. Once I decided to do it, I was supposed to be an artist. I wasn't supposed to be a cop. And it just so happened to work out this way. And I found out that it was a really fun job, and I felt like I did a good thing. When I'd come home every day, I was like, I know that person that I talked to, I dealt with, was really happy that I showed up instead of somebody else.
Yeah.
And I didn't have that issue of, authority. I'm like, okay, I'm going to do my best. And if you don't take my advice, then fine or whatever. But I'm not going to, be that you respect my authority kind of stuff. Cause it's, and I try to instill that in our new cadets, of be very smart, be very aware of your surroundings. Learn the people that you're talking to, learn cues of deception, because believe it or not, cops get assaulted. And get assaulted on a regular basis.
Yes, so they do.
After a while.
More so all the time, because the respect for authority has continually diminished over the decades. Yes.
Yeah. And so you wonder, you talk to that old cop, and that old cop is very crotchety and, keep your distance and this, that. He's learned over the years of being assaulted and watching other cops be assaulted that he's like, I am not going to get hurt today. I don't care whether you don't like me or you think I'm rude or not. I'm not going to get hurt today. And we're going to have this professional interaction. And that's it. And it's a shame that we're some cops get to that point.
But it is the common denominator of fear. Because
and you're watching
they're afraid to get hurt.
I've had many friends from another law enforcement agency that works close to me. Guys that I really respect. Well, two guys that, I worked as a child abuse detective with, and these two guys are the most professional, funny, caring, empathetic, I have not enough good stuff to say about them. They retired as soon as they could. As soon as that number came up, they were gone.
Yeah.
And it's all because of what's happening, and that's what's going around. So we'll see what happens in the next few years with law enforcement and how they're going to handle this. I don't know how they're going to run the jails. We don't have a curve to show that we're hiring more people than are leaving. So when more people are leaving than they're able to hire, that is a huge red flag for 2 years from now, 3 years from now.
Yes. And also in the Department of Education as well.
Oh yeah. Absolutely. The teachers are leaving left and right. And that's not
robes.
That's not, some of the news agencies, some political organizations will say, this isn't a thing. This is hype.
Oh no, this is a crisis. Fighting.
It is a huge deal. It's not a challenge. It's a tragedy. That's what's happening right now.
Yeah, because the best and the brightest and the most mature and the wisest and the most experienced people who we need the most, yourself included, can't wait to get out the door.
Right.
Because the society that we live in now isn't even the society that we lived in 10 years ago. That's how much has changed.
Yeah. I look and see what is happening just in my neighborhood. And I say my neighborhood. So in the county that I live in, there's 52 different police agencies just within that one county. We have 250 something counties in Texas. So the amount of police agencies we have is crazy. And people will go, especially people are from Europe. They're like, what? Why does everybody have a different uniform? Why do they have a different color car? Why do they do this? Why do they do that? When they come from, let's say, Britain or France or whatever, where they have a national police agency.
Right.
Well, you have to remember, Texas is bigger than the country of England. So right. Texas is bigger than the entire country. But also our constitution works differently, where the constitution is designed to weaken the government, not strengthen the government. So it would be terrifying to think that you have an army of all police officers that work under the same policy and under the same person.
Right.
That is a million strong.
Right.
That's a terrifying prospect.
Yeah, that's a terrifying prospect, because then it's just a roll of the dice what kind of person you have in leadership that's calling the shots.
That's right. And what way the political wind is going to blow and how they're going to enforce laws. Because you watch it all the time. One political group will enforce laws a certain way, and then it switches over to the other political group and they do it a different way. And you look at that. And so like in Texas, I want to say around 80% of law enforcement agencies in Texas are less than 50 people entirely in the whole agency.
Right.
So you have the big ones, you know, Houston, Dallas, San Antonio, Austin, El Paso. All the other, these little towns have 20 people. And so they're only, Uvalde, a perfect example, Uvalde, little police agency. Most of the guys that worked at Uvalde have never gone to a active shooter school. They've never been to a school like that. Just a few years ago, I was involved in some policy that was being developed at some schools locally where I live. And this is a huge high school, had no policy on active shooter. And the idea behind it was they didn't want it. They felt that if they talked about it, it would happen.
Well, that's just superstitious.
But their theory behind it is if we practice this and we get policies that the teachers know and they know what to do and all that stuff, the kid that wants to do the shooting will know what our tactics are and he'll be able to overcome those tactics because he knows how this is good. So they just ignore it completely. A bunch of agencies do that. They just rather ignore it completely.
Well, it left them utterly unprepared for Uvalde.
You get an agency that has no training on this at all, or one guy had training 10 years ago and somebody had training recently, and that training is completely contradictory to each other. Mm-hmm. And then you have multiple jurisdictions going in. And then there's what you exactly said, the fear, the liability. Do I want to be the person that runs in there and causes this guy to kill more kids? Because I don't know what's really going on in there. You know, you're getting information. You don't know exactly what's going on. But if I do something that would cause additional kids to be killed, then I'm in trouble as opposed to if I take no action, I can defend myself by saying I didn't know what was really going on and I didn't want to push this any further. To answer that question, you go stop the shooting. I don't care.
Go stop the shooting. Go through.
You hear shooting going on. You go in there and you do that. That's part of your job. And people say, well, I don't want to put my guys in danger. Sorry. That's part
of the job. That's
your job. That's part of the job. So we're getting so much conflicting information from different places. One of the funny things is people are mad at the cops for enforcing laws, mad at the cops. And they're calling to the legislatures to get on board with them and talk bad about the cops. The legislators are the ones that wrote the law. The legislators are the ones that are telling the cops to enforce the law.
What to do and what not to do. And then everybody's mad at the law is that they have to enforce. And you come from a state where, I'm sorry, Greg, but they practically hand you a freaking handgun when you cross the border.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, you live in a state where a lot of people love their guns more than they love their own community members. And that is horrifying to me. On top of that, the ones that are committing these horrific crimes are more well-armed than the police have to stop them.
That's true. What was really surprising to me is when they went to open carry law. So in Texas, if you don't have a felony and you can carry a gun, whether that be a long rifle, shotgun, or a pistol, you can carry it openly. Now, you can't carry it irresponsibly. And if people are scared by your actions, the police can come over there and go, hey, what are you doing? Not just I'm scared because he's got a gun, but he has to be doing something stupid with it, right? What really surprised me is in the first year, we had 32 calls. 32. That's it. I thought that there would be calls left and right about you don't see people carrying guns openly in Austin, Texas. No. You don't see it. It is so rare. I think I've maybe seen two. And you can legally have a holster on your belt exposed with a gun. It is so rare to actually see it. And, you know, normally when you do see it, he's a knucklehead. He's just an idiot. But you got these people that want to exercise their rights. And I'm one of those, remember the communist libertarian thing?
Yeah.
I firmly believe that if you're going to own a gun, you should have a license to do so. You should have training to do it. You should prove proficiency. You should have a background investigation. You should have some sort of personality evaluation to make sure that you're not unstable.
Yeah.
But
that's not that's the way my person.
Yeah. You go Second Amendment. It's like, all right. Well,
yeah. The Second Amendment that, you know, gets twisted and turned to suit its purposes for whatever group that you happen to, you know, be engaging with. You know, here's the thing, Greg, you know, as well as I do. You know, there's 330 million people in this country, and there's 365 million guns that we know of loose on our streets or locked up in cabinets, hopefully somewhere. Right. It's too late. It's too late. There's
you can't do anything about it now.
We have to come to a whole different approach now, because, you know, when the guns outnumber the people, and 70% of the people in this country don't own a gun of any ilk, and 30%
got a bunch of guns, right?
All the rest of them.
Yeah, yeah.
That's a scary proposition in its own right, particularly when the political affiliations of some of these quote unquote militia groups is so extreme that they feel that they can basically overthrow the government at will.
Right.
You know, and
you know, in the United States, we have a threat from within.
Yes, we do.
Canada is not a threat, and no one south is a threat. As far as south of the border of Mexico, Central America, South America.
Well, there are people that would argue that point about immigration.
Well, okay. So there is a real problem with the cartels. Mm-hmm. You can say there's a real problem with the cartels, yes. But in general, whatever invasion is happening, if we want to consider that the cartel invasion now through immigration, it's going to take 50 years for anything to happen and to overthrow our voting system. But my question is, so you know, when we used to in the Cold War, they're talking about, oh, if Russia invades, and you had that the movie Red Dawn, which I really like that movie.
I really like that movie.
That would never happen because guns and logistics. You just can't get enough soldiers from overseas here and feed them and give them ammo. It just wouldn't work.
No.
But I wonder what would have happened if Ukraine had the Second Amendment. Would Russia had been able to go in there when every single citizen was packing? I'm not with a political agenda on this or anything, but I just wonder, would Russia have continued to go in there? Because right now Ukraine is a very much a weapons free zone, right? You can't own weapons in Ukraine. Mm-hmm. So when you want to invade, you just blow up as many of their tanks and soldiers as you can, and you go in, you take over. That would never happen in Houston, Texas. That would never happen in Miami. That would never happen. It couldn't. Well, you know, those people would come out. And I say those people, I mean Americans that had guns. It would just be interesting to see if Ukraine citizenry would have been able to defend themselves. You know, something I can't get out of my head on the Ukraine thing. I was really watching it when it first happened. Russia's warfare is very much different than the United States. United States looks at infrastructure as far as power distribution, airports, and military sites. That's what they go after, and they disable those things.
And Russia goes after the private citizens.
Yes, the
and
people.
Decimates
they just blow up
population
everything.
Indiscriminately.
Isn't
it
crazy?
Something beyond barbaric.
Yeah, yeah.
It crimes against humanity. It is.
I just can't see Putin's war. Yeah,
this is Putin's war.
Yeah.
You know, these poor kids, remember at the very beginning when they were freezing and they were starving and, you know, I think we were into like month two or three and they were hopping out of their tanks and running to farmhouses asking for asylum and they were being handed cell phones so that these boys could call their mommy and tell them that they had survived. You know, I mean, this is heartbreaking in every conceivable way.
Yes.
Here's the paradigm shift, Greg. We have to get to a place in this world where one megalomaniac cannot hold the sword of Damocles to the throat of all of humanity.
I agree.
You know, and while I was at the Star Wars Symposium, and then I want to go back to the whole idea of, a defenseless society, because as soon as Putin started amassing his troops on the Ukrainian border, nobody with a brain thought he was going to say, changed my mind, we're all going back to Moscow.
Everybody knew,
and all of the NATO countries started pouring military equipment into Ukraine to prepare them for what was coming and has been since 2014 when Russia illegally annexed the Crimean Peninsula.
Sure.
And if we had stood up as a country then and along with NATO put our foot down and told him to get out, we wouldn't be where we are now.
I agree.
So, you know, I'm criticizing our leaders then in the same way that I'm criticizing what's happening now in terms of too little too late,
right.
even though we have we have poured, all of NATO has poured trillions of dollars worth of equipment in, but it was not a deterrent because it came too late to be a deterrent. So I see your point of view on that. But no, what I was going to say, I forgot what I was going to say, and it was really important. It was really important. What did I say before I said that? Nobody remembers. Prompt me. It was really important.
I was following you, but I thought you covered.
No, I still had one more point left to make, and it'll come back.
Well, maybe if I, yeah. All right. So the thing I couldn't get out of my head was this woman that is going back into her apartment after the shelling. She's going back into her apartment to try to get some stuff.
Salvage.
And it was blown all to pieces, big hole in the wall. And she took all this stuff and pulled it off of her little baby grand piano and cleared it off and sat down there in that rubble
and
played something. I don't know what she was playing, but it was amazing. And I've watched that many, many times. And the funny thing is, you know, in school, we learn a little bit about history, and we hear about, you know, Franklin, and we talk about Lincoln, and we talk about, you know, whoever. The things that really matter in the long run, it seems to be literature and art, mm-hmm. and music.
Yeah.
And you know, people will hold in reverence the developers of IBM and of Apple and Microsoft, and they'll be able to remember one or two words that are the last names of these people that did some things, which to me, technology really shows what we can do. However, you know, that's the brainiac side, the things that we figure out, but the things that are really human. And I say that in a strange way, because I think the word being humane is a horrible word, because we're not for the most part. It seems like it's the art things that humanity, holds as representations of look what we can do.
Look what we can do. Look what we can create.
Right.
That is our greatest, our superpower, yeah. is love. And our greatest skill is creation of all kind. You know, the best thing that we do as a world order, as one race, is get together for the Olympics every, you know, 2 years. And all the best athletes from all the world compete in peace and love and camaraderie, you know, except for, of course, you know, Munich and, you know, some, I mean, stuff. We've got, yeah. all of those issues, but, you know, those are the rare instances where politics, world politics, infuses right. itself into what is supposed to be a peaceful gathering of all the people of the world. But the thing that we do best individually is to create, whether that be music or literature or art or dance or just communing with the universe. You know, I remembered what I wanted to say when we were at Starworks. My friend Regina Meredith started talking about this concept that she had, or that someone had shared with her, about taking the pyramid and flipping it upside down, so that, you know, those that are at the pinnacle, the ones that manipulate everyone else underneath them, you know, called trickle down economics, you know, and stuff like that, right. you know, take that pyramid intentionally in your mind and flip it, because the masses, the weight and the volume of innocent, peace-loving people will crush the tip of that pyramid and will level the playing field. And that's really what we need to do, because it is the disenchanted, the disassociated, the ones that feel disenfranchised, that are really at the core of the rot that's going on societally, because they're very often, you know, in the country where you can do anything if you just put your mind to it.
Yep.
They're the ones that say, oh, I got cheated. Oh, I'm the victim. Oh, I never got a chance. Oh. And I'm sorry. You know, I mean, there are people that living in Appalachia right now that are living in, you know, what we in this, the rest of the society would look at and say, oh my God, you're still in the dark ages. I mean, you people don't even have heat. You have an outdoor toilet. You don't have electricity. You know, I mean, and these are people that are living in 2022 in the United States of America, in the richest country in the world, that have never, ever seen a leg up, that have never seen anything but abject poverty. And then we wonder why it's the highest death rate from opioids in the entire nation.
Makes you wonder,
in these pockets of poverty. Well, cause and effect, there is a continuum here. There is a reason why, you know, this is what lack of education, lack of social support, a safety net. These people are lost. They're not, you know, they didn't fall through the cracks. They're off the grid. Well, they're off the grid.
And you can see that in the major cities in Texas, major cities in the United States now.
Yeah.
I remember.
The invisible part of the population. And it is most stunning in L.A. It is most stunning in
Absolutely
L.A.
Absolutely horrible.
Every time I go to L.A., I feel like, oh.
I'm in a,
oh, I'm sick. I mean, you're watching Rolls Royces and, you know, and like $150,000 cars that are, you know, with not even looking at the tents that are under the overpasses on both sides of the road. You know, the opulence, the effusive amount of money that so little of the percentage of the population controls, just a couple of percentage points.
Well, I mean,
that money spread equitably through a population where people who, there are a lot of homeless people that have always been that way and have lived that way and don't know any other way to live because they've lived in poverty their whole lives. They were born into it and they grew up in it and they don't know any other way. And there has to be some system. I'm hoping that Karen Bass is the new mayor of LA. This is a big issue for her. And I'm really hoping that she can make a difference because it literally makes me sick to see stretch limousines driving past these people as though they are invisible.
Yeah. And so especially when you look at the problem, they say, we're going to solve the homeless problem by giving them money for tiny houses, or we're going to put them up in an apartment.
No, that's not the answer.
The answer is what you said earlier is the addiction situation that's going on with that community. But see, I got to actually see this transition in 1984, 1985. There was a huge push by do-gooders, and they did mean well. I can see where they meant well, but the do-gooders that did not understand the problem, they just saw human beings that had never committed a crime being incarcerated in state hospitals and state schools because they had emotional challenges or intellectual challenges, right? And so they looked at this and said, no one in the United States should be incarcerated because they have an intellectual challenge or because they are mentally ill. So they changed the laws, and the laws are now, I watched it. I used to answer calls at state schools locally that had staff. This is very rare, but it happens. They had staff that assaulted the people that lived at the state school. So we would go over there and handle that. What happens with people that are activists is they will take one or two horrible things that happen and say, look what happened. We need to stop this. And so they went in and said, these people should not be incarcerated. They shouldn't be stuck here at the state school. And they shut down our state schools in Texas. They shut them down in a lot of different states. And that community was then farmed out to the community, and they live in halfway houses all over.
Group homes, halfway houses, yes.
Yes, and
now, that's called a Band-Aid on cancer.
Oh, it's horrible. I'm telling you, it's so horrible because when I was a kid and also when I first got into law enforcement, you would see the state school buses with a whole bunch of people on them, and they would go to the park. And all these people would come off of the bus and they would be acting very strangely compared to the way everybody else acted. But they would go and have picnics and go look at the river and go look at the, you know, they would have events. They had events at the state school. They ate square meals. They weren't great meals, but they ate food. They had hot meals. They had a clean bed. They had some place to take a bath, and they had social programs. They don't have that anymore. No. None of it. It's horrible because a few attorneys, a few of these politicians that didn't understand the problem said, yeah, they shouldn't be incarcerated. Let them go. Let's get them out of there.
Yeah.
The situation is so much worse.
And that happened during the Reagan administration. That's when it happened.
Well, it did. You're right. It was, I want to say it was around 83 to 85, something like that.
And through that,
on the other side, the state hospitals, okay, you're mentally ill. Are you a danger to yourself or others?
If
you're
not,
if you're not, you're out. And so,
and
where do they go?
Right, exactly. No, you're absolutely right, Greg. And, you know, people, thoughtful people have got to be able to come up with some solutions to these problems that persist in our society. There is no reason in the richest country in the world that anyone should go hungry, that anyone should go without a roof over their head, that anyone should go without education. And, you know, we can talk about these problems all night long, but the point is that we together must find a solution.
That's right.
Together. So, because this is the paradigm shift. If not now, when?
Right.
When? Are we going to wake up and have something shake us to the core and understand that you are my brother, that I am your sister, and that all of us are one?
Our actions, when we make a decision, it needs to be for whatever the betterment of whatever it is.
Not for the greater spite, good.
Not out of doing something for my attention or manipulation.
Yeah.
Because you can say we have a homeless problem. The homeless problem is probably 15% of the homeless population. The problem with the other 85% of that homeless population has to do with their habits and behaviors and capabilities of keeping themselves. You can even give them a room and they won't stay there because
That's absolutely right.
Let's say they're paranoid. Well, they're not a danger to themselves or others. They're out walking around and they're not hurting anybody. So leave them alone. When they damage property or they hurt somebody, we'll pick them up, take them to some sort of facility. They will give them some medication, get them on an even keel and release them again. It's a horrible situation.
It's a cycle. It's a very destructive cycle. We have run out of time.
No.
Apparently, I needed to book you for 3 hours instead of two.
Can I say one thing?
Sure.
One thing. I had a friend of mine that they're like, why do you like plays? Plays are irritating. Why do you like plays? We were talking about technology earlier. We can make a movie. We can make a TV show. We can make the stuff that lasts. It's the little things that happen that disappear into some hole in the sky that make things really special. If we lived forever, it wouldn't be special. I want you to know you're very special to me. So I thank you for having me on there.
I adore you. I adore you and thank you. And I know our viewers enjoyed every moment of the spirited discussion. and I'll have you back again with your lovely bride, Lynn, when she's feeling better.
Thank you.
And we will continue. And I wish you a happy Thanksgiving, Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, Happy Kwanzaa, happy, joy Festivus. Yeah, and I'll call you soon. I love you, darling.
Okay. Love you too.
Good night. Thank you, everyone, for watching tonight. Have a good evening.